Hey, happy Sunday and welcome to the weekly broadcast from the Elim Church in the Holm Valley from our dining room.
Okay.
This is my beautiful wife, Gail. If you were watching last week, you will know what I mean when I say this is my beautiful's wife, Gail. Praise the Lord. It's great to have you with us. We're going to have some worship in a moment from our nephew in Australia, Nathan. We're looking forward to that in a moment. But first of all, Gail's got some announcements for us.
Amen.
So the cafe is going to be delivering meals on Friday. That's meals, puddings, or a sandwich platter if you'd like that. If you would like that delivering to you on a Friday, then you'll need to contact Ian Taylor on 07903 414685 by Thursday. Okay, so that's meals from the cafe. If you'd like to contact us, our number is 01484 323 978. Ian's mobile 07472773243, or you can email us at info@hvelim.org.uk.
Amen. So Nathan's going to lead us in a time of worship right now. Be blessed.
Let's just pray. Lord, we just thank you as we come together right now and just honor your name. We just worship you, give you all the glory, all the praise. Our attention and our focus is set on you. And we just give you all the attention that you deserve and so much more than what we could ever give you. But just right now in this moment, Lord, we just thank you for your presence.
Thank you, Lord, for your presence.
Come on, let's just thank you for his presence.
Thank you, Lord, for your presence, yeah.
We just worship you.
darkness. His love is mighty, so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth, the holy thunder.
Thank you, Nathan. So we've been looking at the names of God over the last couple of months because names
reveal God's character
and his nature. Indeed, Daniel says the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. And I want to be somebody who knows God, who is strong and carries out great exploits for God and knows victory in my life. Hallelujah. Came across this quote from the theologian and commentator AW Tozer this week. He said, "There is nothing more important about you than what comes to mind when you think about God." I think what he's saying here is that your perception of God, what you think about God, will ultimately be reflected in the way that you relate to God. So let's just put a few key examples here. If you think that God is a spy in the sky with a lightning bolt in his right hand, ready to zap you the moment you put your foot out of step, how are you going to relate to him?
Well, you're going to be scared, frightened, draw away.
Yeah. If you think that God is somebody who wound up the clock of the universe at creation and then walked away and is there letting the world get on with itself, how will you relate to God now?
Well, you would think he wasn't interested in you and that he didn't care about you.
So if we think that God is not bothered about us, if we think that he's not interested in our plight, why approach him? Why bother going to him in prayer? Why bother to relate to him? Because he's not interested in you one bit. If you see him as an aggressive figure who punishes and judges, that will reflect the way that you relate to him. You won't dare approach him. If you do, you'll be treading on eggshells. And think about this, that if we have a negative concept of God, that will ultimately reflect in our relationship with him, that will ultimately reflect in our intimacy with him, which will ultimately reflect in our fruitfulness, our growth, receiving blessings from him, knowing his love. If the concept is wrong, then that will impact on our lives. As well as the very fact that if our concept is right, that will also impact upon our lives. Because if we think that God is a loving, generous Father who cares about us, who's interested in us, how will that reflect our relationship?
Well, we're going to trust him and want to draw close to him and know him more, be in that intimate relationship with him.
And we're going to want to know everything that he has for us. Kent Hughes, another commentator, says this: the idea that God is our Father, our Abba, we'll get onto that in a moment, is not only a sign of our spiritual health and authenticity of our faith, it is one of the most healing doctrines of Scripture. Going back to Tozer then, nothing in life is as important as what comes to mind when we think about God. If we don't understand that God is our loving Father, we won't also understand that we're his precious child. God wants you to see him as your loving Father, Abba Father, the God who would say, call me Dad. And that is the name that we're going to unpack this week. The name that we're looking at is Abba. Tap Abba into Google and you're going to get 81 million hits. 81 million hits for what though?
The Swedish pop group, I should imagine.
Yes, indeed. All right. And for the, if you've got Abba relating to God, you get 14 million hits, which again expresses the fact that Abba is one of these words like hallelujah. It's universal. Go to anyone around the world and say hallelujah. They'll understand that you're saying praise the Lord. Go to any Christian around the world and you say Abba. They know that you're referring to Abba, our Father. Chuck Swindle says the Aramaic Abba stems from what might be called baby talk. According to the Jewish Talmud, when a child is weaned, it learns to say Abba, Daddy, and Imma, Mummy, straight away. In time, the meaning of the word broadened so that it was no longer a form of address used by little children, but it was used by adult sons and daughters as well. The childish character of the word diminished, and Abba acquired the warm, familiar ring which we may feel in such an expression as Dear Father. That's Chuck Swindle saying that. Now, we've ditched our TV license, so we don't watch any live television. Anything that we watch is on catch-up or on one of these subscription services, and we've got Amazon Prime. And I noticed there the other day that there was the 1970s edition of film of The Railway Children. Good gracious me. And in the closing scene of The Railway Children, I don't know whether you're familiar with this, Jenny Agutter is stood on Oakworth Station and the train pulls in and everybody disembarks and then the steam and the smoke clears from the engine, and just in the distance there is her dad at the other end of the platform, and she runs to her father and she says, "My daddy, my daddy," and puts her arms around him. Now, this is the kind of expression that we're talking about now that is meant by Abba, Abba Father. It's one of deep affection. It's not, "Oh, hello, Father." It's, "Hello, Father, I love you," and giving him a big hug kind of thing. Now, they don't make them like that nowadays, do they? Think about this for a moment, that as a preacher, you know, I'm stood there at a church and I'm preaching away about the Heavenly Father. And in my mind, perhaps naively, I'm thinking that the perception that you've got in your minds is one of a caring and loving and protective Father. But because of your experience, what is coming to your mind is somebody who is aggressive, somebody who is abusive, somebody that is absent, somebody who doesn't care. I don't know whether you remember this. A few years back, Gal, we in the church calendar, there are all kinds of events that you can have special services for. Obviously, you're not going to miss Christmas and Easter, and you'll have Mother's Day. And we sat down one year thinking, well, shall we do Father's Day? Shall we have the children do a card for their dad, and shall we get them some gifts to give out, just like we do when we give out flowers and gifts and write cards when it's Mother's Day? Shall we celebrate Father's Day in a similar fashion? So I was pondering this, and then we got to the point where we thought, well, so-and-so has just lost their father. They, you know, the father has recently died, so it wouldn't be a good service for them. Well, so-and-so, their family has just been devastated by the fact that the father has walked out and gone to live with another woman. So start talking about fathers, and well, that won't be good for that family. And, oh, the family on the back row, well, there's some children there that are each the children of different fathers, and those children don't have a relationship with those fathers. In fact, they don't even know who that father is. It's interesting, actually, that in the UK, I don't know what it's like worldwide, but there's a great proportion of birth certificates now that do not mention the name of the father, because often the mother doesn't know who the father is. Good gracious me. And then I started thinking about somebody else that, you know, who nobody else knew this about, this particular person, but their father had abused them, not just emotionally, but sexually as well. So if we had a service for Father's Day, it was not going to be good for many, many people. So in the end, we carried on as normal, and we didn't even pay any homage to the fact that it was Father's Day at all. You see that what I'm getting around to saying is that we can so easily base our perception of our Heavenly Father on our experiences of our earthly father. One who is aggressive, one who is moody, one who you then approach not knowing what side of bed he'd got out of that day. You dare not walk in the room asking him for anything. One who is absent, one who's walked out on you, one who's left you, one who's left the family suffering, one who's walked out and doesn't care, one who's not interested in your plight, one who is abusive emotionally or sexually, and all you're feeling is worthless, guilty and dirty. Trouble is, we can magnify our earthly experience, magnify that up a million times, and that's our snapshot of our Heavenly Father. Whereas what we should be doing is magnifying love, care, protection, and that should influence our image, our perception of our Heavenly Father. God has consistently, from the beginning of time, and again, revealed himself as a perfect and loving, caring father. If we look to Psalm 68:5, for example, in the Old Testament, a father of the fatherless, a defender of the widows. And the Old Testament started what Jesus would finish and the Holy Spirit would reveal to us. He is the powerful creator of the universe, but he is also your loving, personal, connected dad. Father is only used 13 times of God in the Old Testament, but Jesus used the term father referring to God 150 times and as our father 30 times. And I guess one of the pivotal points of our understanding of God as our Father is when the disciples came to him and asked him, how do we pray? And Jesus said, this is how you should pray. When you pray, you should pray like this. Our Father. Our Father. You approach him like a child approaches their earthly father. Not as some remote person, not some person that perhaps you knock on the door and gingerly put your head around the corner wondering whether they're in a good mood or not, but our loving Heavenly Father. Jesus' use of this term brings a whole new understanding of our relationship with God. Dr. George Caird said this, Jesus transformed the Father of God from a theological doctrine into an intense and intimate experience, and he taught his disciples to pray with the same intimacy. The way that you see God is the way that you're going to relate to God. Matthew 7:11 says this, and he says that our Heavenly Father is not mean, nasty, a father who does things out of spite or who does things to frighten you or make your life a misery. This is what it says. Or who is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone, or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give good gifts to those who ask him? The picture should stay with us. That should stay with us is a loving Heavenly Father who is more generous than any earthly father who loves to give good gifts to us. And then Romans 8:15 says this, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry, Abba Father. We haven't been given a spirit of fear, again to fear. You know, the fear is about being good enough and being able to approach God. You see, in the Old Testament, the idea was that you could only approach God if you were perfect, if you had obeyed the law. And then if you'd obeyed the law, well, then you might be worthy to poke your head around the door and say hello to God. And there was a great fear of judgment and a great fear of God's wrath. But we no longer need to live under that spirit of fear. We've not been given a spirit of fear of God, wondering whether we will ever make the mark. But we have been given the spirit of adoption. The Holy Spirit has made the fact that real, that God is our Father. Galatians 4:6 says this, and because you are sons, God sent forth the spirit of his sons into your heart, crying out, Abba, Father. We haven't got to spend the rest of our lives working off our debt, wondering whether we are good enough. We are accepted by our loving Father. The Holy Spirit not only helps us to see how God should be seen by us as our loving Heavenly Father, but also the Holy Spirit helps us to see that we should be seen as his children. Now, how do I practically grasp this truth? How do I begin to walk in this truth in confidence? I'm glad that you asked. Now I'm going to just look at one verse from John. John was a man who grew up under Old Testament theology. And again, he was one of these persons who saw God as remote. And, you know, as a Jew, he was somebody who dare not mention God's name. He dare not mention the name Yahweh for fear that he was going to violate the fifth commandment and get a zap from heaven and be dealt with once and for all. That was the fear that John had lived under. But then John has a revelation, and this revelation we can read about in 1 John 3:1. And this is it. It says, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. And that is what we are." So this is John speaking to us. And I want you to notice in this verse from 1 John 3:1, the NIV translates it, "See what great love the Father has for us." That word "see" is translated in the King James Version, guess it, yes, it's that word "behold" again. Praise the Lord. And we've looked at that word "behold" on previous occasions. And I'll say it again, because that word "behold" means, hey up, here is an important bit of theology. Here is an important thing for you to grasp. Here is something that you need to get a revelation of. It is "behold." The scripture is inspiring John here to say, hey, stop, pay attention, listen up, prick your ears up. This is in fluorescent pen. This is underlined. This is in bold writing. This is important. So what revelation do we need to get from this here? Number one, rest in God's love. You do not become a child of God because you do anything to be loved. You become a child of God because He is love. There is nothing that God can do but love you. Praise the Lord. That is His character. And do you notice what John says? It is great love. Not a little bit of love. Not a smidgen of love. Do you know what I mean by a smidgen of love? Just a small bit of love. Not just a standard bit of love. But great love. Not just nice love. Not just cool love, but great love. The Amplified Version of the Bible renders it wonderful love. Wonderful, great love. His character is great. His character is love. His love is great. His love is bigger than your fear. His love is bigger than your burden. His love is bigger than your doubt. His love is bigger than your insecurity. His love is bigger than your sin. His love is bigger than your guilt. Hallelujah. The second thing that I want you to see is not only to rest in His grace, but the second thing is to receive His grace. See what great love the Father has lavished on us. Now, lavish is quite a descriptive word. It means to pour out generously. Now, Gail and I have been to Italian restaurants in the past. I won't mention them by name because they might sue us because of what I'm about to say. But whenever you go to an Italian restaurant, your pizza gets delivered or your spaghetti bolognese gets delivered, and the waitress or the waiter walks over and says, "Do you want some Parmesan cheese?" And the waitress has the Parmesan cheese either in a grated bowl already, or she's ready to grate it over a grater over your meal. And the reason why the waiter and the waitress grate the meal for you or deliver that portion for you is because they don't want you to have too much, because Parmesan cheese is too expensive and they want to get away with the least amount that they can give you as possible. So that's why they do that. They don't want you to have the bowl yourself and heap it on, because that would be too dear for them. But when God lavishes His grace upon us, it's not just the minimum that He can get away with. It's not that He's being mean and saying, "Well, I'm just going to give you a little bit of love today." It's a lavish, generous outpouring of His love. He brings all the Parmesan cheese that there is in the place and He just piles it on, hallelujah, abundantly. You cannot become a child of God by buying it or earning it. You receive it. And His love is abundant, overflowing, an overflowing measure. Love without measure. It's not about what you've done. It's about what he's done. It's not about your effort, it's about his effort. It's not about your righteousness, it's about his righteousness. It's not about your blood, it's about his blood. Because that ultimate gift of love is possible because of Jesus being given to us. That he would go to the cross on our behalf, paying the penalty for our sin, taking the wrath of God on our behalf, taking the anger of God on our behalf, so that now when he looks at us, he sees us as he sees Jesus, perfect. And here's a beautiful thing for us just to ponder for one moment, that God loves us as much as he loves Jesus. He doesn't love Jesus any more than he loves us. He doesn't love Jesus any less than he loves Jesus. Hallelujah. Wow. We need to rest in this grace. We need to receive this grace. Hallelujah. But then also the last thing that I want you to see from this is that we need to allow him, our Father, to rename us. See, behold, what great, not just a standard, but great love the Father has lavished abundantly on us, that we should be called the children of God. Hallelujah. He loves us just as much as his son Jesus. And that is what we are. We are the children of God. We are called the children of God. He has renamed us. There are many names that I have been called in the past. I won't mention them. Perhaps there are many names that you've been called in the past. You may have been called failure. You may have been called mistake. You may have been called accident. You may have been called not as good as your sister or your brother. You may have been called unworthy. You may have been called dirty. You may have been called good for nothing. Other people may have called you that, but do you know what? Only one person has the ultimate authority to give you your proper name. And that is God. And he calls you my precious child. Hallelujah. You are not a mistake. You failed, but you're not a failure. You are not unworthy. You are precious. You are not overlooked. You are the apple of his eye. You are not someone lost in the crowd. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. And God pays particular attention to your life because you're his child and he loves you. You are my daughter. You are my son. You are my child. Call me dad. I've got good things to share with you. Ray Pritchard says this, that we can cry out Abba Father is truly good news. You don't have to scream to God to get his attention. You simply say Daddy, and he hears your voice. You whisper his name in the darkness and he comes to your aid. Every father understands this principle. I can be in a room filled with people and a welter of voices, but let one of my sons say, Daddy, and somehow I will hear his voice. I don't know how that happens, but it does. A father knows when his children are speaking to him. The same is true with our Heavenly Father. He hears the faintest cry of his children. He is not aggressive or mean. He's not got a thunderbolt in his right hand ready to zap you at every false move. He's here today, ready to listen to you. You don't have to fear his presence. You can enjoy his presence and know that he sings and delights over you. Yes, he sings and delights over you. He wants to protect you. He wants you to understand and appreciate and come into a full understanding of every blessing that he has for you, because you're part of his family, made possible because of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Gail, have you got something to say?
Amen. Yes, Ian, thank you. Now, you just mentioned there that Father God sings over us, sings over his children. He rejoices over his children. Let me read you the scripture in the Old Testament where that is mentioned. It's Zephaniah 3:17, a beautiful scripture. The Lord your God in your midst, the mighty one, will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Isn't that amazing that God rejoices and sings over his children? The contemporary English version puts it like this: he celebrates and sings because of you, and he will refresh your life with his love. God, our Father, is excited about his children, celebrating, singing, showing us his love. 2 Corinthians 6:18 says, I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters. God longs for each of us to be his child, to be a child in his family. He wants a relationship with us. He wants to be our Father. And through Jesus, as Ian says, every provision has already been made for the forgiveness of our sins, so that we're not separated from God, but we can have that intimate, close relationship with him. Father's love will outweigh the sum of everything negative in our lives. Let me just say that again. Our Father's love, our Heavenly Father's love, will outweigh the sum of everything negative in our lives. Hallelujah. We can't fathom the depths of his great love, but we can accept it. Amen. And we can accept it by accepting Jesus as our Lord and Saviour. If you don't know what it is to be a child of God, maybe you'd like to pray this prayer with me. Receive Jesus as your Lord and Saviour. And then know what it is to be a child of God. Know what it is to receive his love. And know that love refreshing your life, as the scripture says. Hallelujah. Let's pray then. Father, thank you that when Jesus died on the cross, he took the punishment for all my sin, so I no longer need to be separated from you. Jesus opened the way for me to become part of your family, a child of God. So Jesus, I receive you now as my Lord and Saviour. Come into my heart. And Father, I thank you that I am now a child of God, and that right now I am receiving your love, and that you are rejoicing over me with singing. And that as I learn to press into that relationship with you as your child, that love, your great love, your abundant love will refresh my life, and I will never be the same again. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, that I am now a child of God. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I just want to pray that today we get a greater revelation of God's love towards us. For each individual, wherever you are on your journey with God, whether you're a new believer, whether you've been a believer for 6 months, 6 years, or 60 years, I believe that God today wants to give you a greater revelation of his love towards you. And so, Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would witness to our spirits that great love that you have for us, that abundant love, that lavish love, that great love, and that you love us as much as you love your son, Jesus. In fact, you treat us as your child. Thank you, Lord, that we are your children. Holy Spirit, give us greater revelation and make that real to us today, so that we can enter into a relationship with you whereby we receive the goodness that you have for us. Amen. Amen. Don't forget, if you want to get in touch with us, 01484-323-978 is the number. You can call me on my mobile, 0747-277-3243. If you want to email us with prayer requests, with blessings, info@hvelim.org.uk is the email address. So until we see you again from our dining room table next Sunday, don't forget that we love you, God loves you, and that God is on your side. Bye-bye for now. Bye.
At the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, the guns fell silent on the Western Front to bring to an end the First World War. Our nation and Commonwealth has recalled that moment through our armistice and remembrance events down the decades. Decades during which the men and women of our armed services have continued to pay the ultimate sacrifice. And so many years later, we remember lives sacrificed in the service of our country and those traumatized and injured in conflict. May we have such a devotion to justice and freedom that the heroism of all who fought and still fight may continue to be remembered in a nation of service and in a world of peace. Jesus said, "There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends since I have told you everything the Father told me. Let us remember before God and commend to his sure keeping those who have died for their country in war, those whom we knew and whose memory we treasure, and all who have lived and died in the service of mankind. They shall not grow old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them."